So hi everyone, and welcome to GLR Stories to Tell, session number two. To the side of me, we've got David Faulkner tonight, most of the participants are students from the video design courses at the GLR. All my students are doing their curriculum right now, doing video during the day. And we are really interested in what you do during the day, David, in your video world. Were you always interested in video, TV, film?
Yeah, sure. Actually, can I just check, is my sound okay?
Sounds okay. Perfect, yeah, absolutely.
I just realized I forgot to plug headphones in,
okay.
Which I usually do. But let me know if it's bad and I can grab a pair in like 30 seconds. But yeah, so I guess I've always been interested in like drawing and painting, you know, as a kid. I'm not talking about great art. I'm just talking about, you know, as a child, enjoying mucking around with art. And, you know, as you get a bit older, become like a teenager and your teachers start talking to you about maybe your career options or directions. So maybe my art teacher had sort of said, oh, you know, you're good at art. Maybe you should think about art and design as a career path. And I guess I wasn't hugely academic in terms of interested in maths and science. And so I kind of found the art thing a nice idea. And I ended up going to art college. And at that time, round about, you know, the age of 15 or 16, I would have been sort of playing with my first ever camera and maybe joining like a photo club, photography club, at my sort of like art college. Around about 16, 17, getting a little bit into photography. So that's obviously where you start getting used to film and lenses and your exposures and things like that. And I guess it's that thing, you know, you get interested in one thing, like, oh, photography, that's cool. Huh. And then you're like, oh, but photography, but with movement, now that's maybe even cooler. So, like, you know, maybe I'll try film and video as opposed to just still photography. And it's just really your curiosity, you know, my curiosity that sort of takes me in this direction. And so after like a year of art college, we call it in the UK, we call it a foundation course, which is 1 year.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that, you're at the level of being about 17, 18 years old, and you start thinking about doing a degree. So, and I chose to do a degree called Media and Design. And it was kind of a general course. We did a bit of graphic design, a bit of 3D design, and we did some what we call lens-based media to kind of cover photography, film, and video. So we got lens-based, and we did some theory as well. And I picked the lens-based as my specialism. So, you know, there was 40 students on the course in 1 year, you know, 10 did lens-based, 10 did whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I did the lens-based thing and, you know, you get into it. And it's great at college or school, you know, you get the chance to be an editor, do some graphics, be a director, and you'll start to get that feel for where you feel comfortable, because, you know, maybe not everyone has the kind of the outgoing personality that sometimes you might need to be a director. So you might find like you prefer post-production or special effects because, you know, it might just be your character, it suits you, or, you know, and it's very much a sort of an organic way that I found like my move in that direction. And then obviously after my degree, I'd sort of been playing with video and film. Back in the day, it was all on tape, so it wasn't, you know, non-linear the way you guys will be experiencing it. But it was great. It was good fun. And that sort of set me off on my journey into sort of which became television, which is where I found myself working.
Cool. Yes.
Is that?
Cool. That sounds a bit like the career path that you could choose at our school as well. We even doubted about calling our department lens-based media as well. Didn't make it though, but yeah, cool. And do you consider yourself more happy in front of the camera or doing the post-production stuff?
It's interesting. I think, you know, there's probably quite a lot of people around who are, you know, like, we like things to be perfect. Mm-hmm. And in a way, it's easier to get things perfect in post-production. So, you know, with After Effects, you can put a keyframe, and you put another keyframe, and you think, you know, like, I'm going to nudge that keyframe a frame. And then you go, I'm going to put easy ease in this keyframe, you know, and the level of detail you can put on something is really precise. And there's something about that my character likes. So I'm not really in post, but I don't use After Effects that much. So I use Premiere mainly. And it's kind of maybe a midway place. So maybe it suits me because I'm not 100%, you know, finesse or, you know, perfection. But there's a part of my character that likes that. And then, like, say, 2 days ago, we were doing a shoot. And I sometimes find shoots kind of slightly stressful because you prepare for it and then you go and you've got, you know, you've got a location, you've got your crew, castings, you've got your what we call talent, the stars, you know, art department, everyone, you know, and it's all there for one day and you've got to get everything you need in that one day.
You need to do it right. Yeah.
So it's not like you can't. You know, tomorrow you can say, you know what? I think that keyframe was better where it was. Like with the shoot, what you get on that day, that's it.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then, you know, I can see that in myself, that I slightly find that a bit stressful, you know, like that kind of, wow, it's all or nothing today. But at the same time, there's a kind of an energy that you get from that and a little bit of magic. So, you know, the best thing about this job for me is it's kind of like a team job. So, like, I'll come up with an idea, I'll write a script, and I'll maybe do an offline edit, but then I'll show my script to my boss or a colleague, and they might make a suggestion. And I can, you know, if it's a good suggestion, I'll be like, oh, great, and it's made my script better.
Yeah.
And then I'll go to online edit with another editor, and they might do something to the edit, and they might say, hey Dave, why don't we do, like, you know, some dips to black, or why don't we do, like, you know, a fast montage. And again, if it works, I'm like, wow, you know, they've brought something to my project that I hadn't really seen myself. And similarly, you'll then go to graphics and audio, and if you're working with good people, they'll add a level of their own talent to the project that you are working on together. And the best bit is that, you know, at the end, when you look at the finished thing and it's greater than, you know, that in England we say, or in English, we say that greater than the sum of the parts.
Okay, yeah.
So everyone's done a little bit, but everything's just better than, and particularly better than, you know, the person like me starting really anticipated or hoped for. So yeah, it's interesting about finding out where your character, you know, your personality will fit on that journey from idea through to, you know, pre-production, production, and post-production. So yeah, that takes, I don't know, just experimentation.
Yeah,
there's no easy answer.
True. Well, for tonight, you've prepared slides, and you're going to talk about making promos. Quite a lot, I think.
Yeah.
And that's what my students are doing at the moment as well, making promos. But you're going to talk about making promos for TV shows. So I'm going to switch the workspace into your slides. And while you're doing your presentation, I'm going to hide my camera, but I will still be around and keeping an eye out for the chat. For my students, when you've got your questions along the way, please let me know in the chat, and then we'll get probably get the answers directly from David, or we'll keep them until the end. So David, yeah, the floor is yours, and have fun.
Thank you very much. Okay, so so you've already met me. I'm Dave Faulkner. I'm what's called a TV promo creative. That's kind of a standard job title. It's changed over the years. Sometimes we get called a promo director. Sometimes we get called a promo producer. Creative became a kind of a buzzword about maybe 10 years ago. Anyway, it's all much of a muchness. I'm based in London and I work in the broadcast television sector. So broadcast TV, when I think about that, I'm thinking about big channels. So I'm not talking about corporate video, and I'm not talking about movies. And normally talking really about commercials. They're all kind of different areas. Very similar, but you probably will find that if you stick with this as a career, you'll go down a route. So the broadcast TV sector. So I don't know if you guys are that familiar with the UK TV scene, but the BBC, BBC One, BBC Two, big channels like that, Channel 4, ITV, big broadcasters are the sort of people that I work for, which can be good or bad. So just moving on. So promos are what we would call short form. And say if you were working on like a feature film or maybe a drama that was 30 minutes or 60 minutes long in each episode, you would call that long form. But promos are short form, so are commercials. Just put like, typically a promo that I'll make is 15 to 60 seconds long. We also do things like sponsorship bumpers. So that's where like maybe a brand, like Coca-Cola, when you're watching a show, sometimes you'll have like, this show is brought to you by Coca-Cola, just 5 seconds long or even shorter. And commercials, I've put that in there. I don't really do commercials hardly ever, but they're a form of short form production. This presentation here was something that I did a couple of weeks ago, and it was really about storytelling. And I think that's interesting. That storytelling, I love stories. I think stories are great, people love stories, and film and video is a great medium for this. Obviously in short form, we don't have a lot of time for storytelling. How do you tell somebody a story in 15 or 60 seconds? But that's part of my job. I'll just talk to you a little bit about my typical workflow in a project. So just I'm a freelancer, so currently I'm working for Disney, but 2 months time I'll be working for someone else, which is good. I get a bit of variety. And again, that could be a thing in your careers. You might find sometimes you're working for a company as a staff member for years, or sometimes you go freelance. But anyway, the workflow is the same really, whether you're freelance or staff. So my client will give me a brief. They'll say, okay, we want to promote such and such a thing, a new TV show, a movie, whatever it is. And the brief will give me my sort of kind of key thoughts, who the audience they want to reach are. Is it, male, female, young, old, that kind of thing. I'll go off and start coming up with ideas and coming up with a script. So usually you try and come up with 2 or 3 ideas. And very often you bring together the best bits of all 3 ideas into one overall idea that the client likes. I'll work on my script, and then I'll move quite quickly into offline edit. And that's a great thing about, Premiere. You've got it on your laptop, you've got easy access to it, and it's easy to use. You don't need to book an edit suite with an editor, so you can start working. Around about this time, I'll be thinking about briefing graphics if I need additional graphics added on. Later in the project, once I've done my offline edit and things are kind of approved by my client, we'll go to online edit to conform and to make it high res, all the graphics, etc. And after that, usually we'll go to audio. And in audio, we kind of finish off with the script that will be voiced by a voiceover artist. And we do the final mix, just make sure everything's really as nice as possible. And also, we call about making it legal, which is both for edit and audio, in terms of you set the volume levels, and you also set the luminance levels of the pictures to sort of industry standard levels, so that when it gets transmitted, it looks good on people's televisions. I don't have to worry too much about that. That's a techie job. So this is just a picture I took of a desk that I've been working at very recently. This is at Disney, and this is a very standard setup for somebody like me. And I've got a MacBook Pro. The one that you see there is not mine, that belongs to Disney. But they're kind of, the MacBook Pros are kind of like the default computer at the moment, mainly because I think of the ProRes codecs. Yeah, very popular. And you tend to, like, they do a lot of hot desking. So you go to a desk that's got an external monitor and an external keyboard. So that laptop you're looking at is a 13-inch screen, so way too small to really work on properly. And the monitor that you're looking at there, I think, is maybe 24 inches, which is probably a little bit small. 27 would be better, but it's fine. 24 is fine. So yeah, most of us have Adobe CC, you know, from the clients that we work for. And I use Premiere Pro, that's my main tool. But because we've got CC, we've got After Effects, we've got Photoshop, etc. So I use Premiere Pro daily. I use After Effects occasionally, and I'm not an expert. You know, I can dabble, and I'm similar with Photoshop. So maybe if you just want to mock up something to show, like, a kind of an offline of a graphic, but then I would really go to graphics to get things made up properly, because they can do it very well and very quickly. And then obviously we use Office. We don't use Office for editing, but for writing scripts. So, you know, just in my current role, we're using a lot of Excel. So you maybe find that when you get into the professional world, projects, they have a, you know, a big administrative back end, and you'll be using Excel, PowerPoint for pitches, and Office for scripting. So obviously you can use Google Docs, Google Sheets, etc., but this is just a very much a standard setup. So this is a picture of a friend of mine, Simon Kotovich, who's a very good sort of editor and motion graphics guru. So he will use After Effects and Cinema 4D, which has become kind of the default for motion graphics in the broadcast sector. Most people are really good with both After Effects and Cinema 4D. Some people only use one or the other, but I would say it feels like, you know, 80% of people are good with both of them. That's kind of the current trend. This is a picture of an online edit suite. So if you think back to me, I'm going to click back. I don't know if you see. So me with my one little laptop and a monitor. Then we go here. So this is the full edit suite. On the far left, just above the guy's head, you can see the monitor that's got the scopes that shows him that the video levels are good. He's just got a lot more screen real estate, but he's running Premiere. So essentially, if you know Premiere, you're in a really good place. And then audio, at the end of the project, we go to audio. The audio guys in London tend to use Pro Tools mainly. It's the most popular. I'm not really, audio is a bit of a sort of dark art to me. But this is a pretty typical audio suite with a nice mixing desk, but running Pro Tools as a software. And this is a VO booth. Again, you know, voiceover for a script is very much a key part of 9 out of 10 promos that I would make. A voiceover booth that has got a high quality microphone is essential, and good soundproofing. I just see, I've been doing this kind of work for a long time. I don't know if you see, I have no hair. I'm getting on, man. Yeah, so I've been doing this kind of when I first started TV. I was doing more kind of TV shows, like half an hour shows, and then I moved into promos maybe after about 3 years. So I've probably been doing it like, nearly 20 years, and it suits me. I like this because the projects are quite short, so it means that maybe I've got a short attention span, so it means I work on a new project quite quickly. So if you ever want to do something like a feature film, it might take you 3 years of your life to get it from start to finish, or more easily. The kind of projects that I work on, from start to finish might be 1 month. So I get a lot of variety. So just going back to storytelling, as a promo maker, apart from telling a little story, I'm really trying to sell the product, by which I mean, like, if I'm making a promo, I'm trying to get an audience to watch it. I'm just going to talk about a movie promo. A movie is something that's already made. If you think of like a Star Wars movie, I have nothing to do with the making of that. The story of that movie is already made. But so I'm trying to make other people watch that. So maybe what I'll do is I'll tease the story. I'll set it up. Oh, what's going to happen? Here are the key characters. But we always have to make sure we avoid what we call spoilers. We don't want to give any story away. But the main thing is to get as many people to watch as possible, because that's how the companies that I work for make money, through high audience figures. So this, I'm just going to play next, a promo, which is a movie promo. It's quite a few years old. It was a movie called Man on Fire, and I made this when I was working on a movie channel. So just I'm gonna play that.
From director Tony Scott.
She's dead.
Denzel Washington. Christopher Walken. Mickey Rourke.
Revenge is a meal best served cold.
Man on Fire, one of 20 movies now showing on Sky Box Office.
Okay, so that was a promo for a movie called Man on Fire. So in terms of, like, telling a story, it's the who, what, where, when, why, how. So in this instance, I don't have time to tell the details, but that would be boring anyway. But I'm kind of setting it up. Denzel Washington is an ex-assassin. There's a kidnap. It happens in Mexico. I know you can't really tell that from the promo, but you can tell, I guess, that it's South America or Central America. And you get the sense that there's a revenge element that's quite explicit. And what I'm trying to do is get you excited and get you intrigued. When you watch this promo, I want you to go, oh yeah, that looks like a cool story or an exciting story. I'd like to watch that. But then, because I'm a promo maker, we also have what I'm calling selling points, the stars and the director. So quite often, you'll see, like, from the director of, or starring, Brad Pitt or Scarlett Johansson, because some people will just watch a thing, even if it's rubbish, but because it's got their favorite actor or a big star. So there are, things like that, the stars, the director, maybe from the producer of, from the writer of, can be selling points. And the key thing, again, just reminding that I mustn't give away the ending, because if I give away the ending, there's no point in people watching the movie. That was a dark and moody movie. The next one is a TV quiz show promo. So this is one. And this is one. So if you think the movie, I get given the movie and I just pick, you know, I edit clips. I choose different music and I write a script, do a bit of graphics or whatever, but I'm not creating, I'm not shooting anything. So for this one, this next one coming up, we did a shoot. So again, I'm just cool.
Enough bouncing, bed.
But Mum?
Yes?
Why isn't there a celebrity comedy game show about movies on the telly?
A celebrity comedy game show about movies? Honestly.
Andy, if you make it, they will watch.
I'll call it Popcorn Trailer Guy.
Popcorn.
The dream comes true. Popcorn with Andy Goldstein. Saturday at 7:30 on Sky Movies 1.
I am your father.
Okay, so Popcorn was a TV show, movie quiz show. So for me to sell this, they hadn't made the show. So I had no material to work with. So that's why we partly why we did a shoot. And I wanted to create a story to explain, you know, how do you explain the show without just telling people that this is a show, it's a movie quiz show. So we did the kind of the backstory of the it's a boy who wonders why there isn't a movie quiz show on TV, and he grows up to be the host of the TV show. So it was a way of getting the presenter into the promo. You know, to try and help support in such a short time, you know, the narrative can't tell the whole story. So you're relying on things like art department and wardrobe to help give people, you know, the audience watching the cues they need. Like, you know, what's the era? What's the setting? So he's a young kid. He's in his bedroom. He's talking to his mum. And then the voiceover style, I don't know if you kind of heard the American gravelly voice. So that was, you know, what we call like a trailer voiceover, a movie trailer voiceover. And the guy we got to do that is a guy called Red Pepper, who's got an amazing voice. So he was the voice of the poster, I suppose, and at the end. And then the presenter had the Star Wars joke at the end, you know, that I am your father, which helps sort of reinforce the movie concept. So this one's a kind of a promo where I get to create a small story. And we did a shoot, it was great fun in a studio. And there was, I guess, some special effects. How do we get the poster to come to life? So quite good fun. I just see the edit program. So the edit software that I use currently is Premiere Pro. Been using Premiere Pro for quite a few years. Sorry, jumped ahead. But I've used Final Cut Pro a bit, and I've used Avid quite a lot as well. So, you know, up until about 5 years ago, I was using Avid all the time, Avid. And Premiere Pro has kind of maybe taken over. So yeah, Premiere Pro is definitely the software that I would recommend learning if you're picking one at the moment. So my next spot is a Mafia season promo. So this is a season of Mafia gangster related movies for a movie channel. And I'm just gonna maximize this, play this for you.
I'm gonna make him an offer again with you.
I always wanted to be a gangster.
Keep your friends close, but your enemies closer.
What'd you say? Are you being a wise guy with me?
I got an informer in my outfit.
It's not personal, it's strictly business.
We're not asking you to take orders, Joe. We're telling you.
And you wanted to know how to get to Capone.
Tell him maybe it's time he should quit.
What do you mean funny? Funny how am I funny?
Do you want him to chop me up and feed me to the poor?
Where is he?
What are you gonna do?
Did you think you could steal from me?
Who do I trust? Me!
Come on, no, not here, not here.
It's time to show a little respect. The definitive Mafia season starts Monday the 31st on Sky Movies Modern Greats.
Okay, so that was another shot promo. That was good fun. So in this one, what we're in terms of storytelling, again, it's kind of storytelling within the world of my short format promo making. I was trying to establish the setting. You know, it's American gangster movies, you know, The Godfather, Scarface, so American crime, but very much mafia related. So we used the Italian opera music to kind of give that Italian connection. As usual with promos, I'm trying to build some sense of intrigue to get people interested. So the promo starts off, you can see the truck, you can see the police, you get that sense of, oh, something's happened, what's inside the truck. The doors open and we go in. And again, we see the meat, so that the hanging meat, the carcasses, that suggests, you know, the nature of a lot of brutality, death or murder, which, you know, people relate with gangster movies, mafia movies. But this is all happening visually, and there's no voiceover script so much. But we used dialogue clips from the films, and the dialogue clips, they start off quite gentle, you know, general, yeah, hey, I always wanted to be a gangster. But as it builds, we sort of build the intensity, you know, and with the clips until it gets to, you know, the guy begging for his life in a panicky voice, and then we hear the gunshot, and that's the climax. So we're kind of creating a narrative structure. You know, you start off maybe slow, gentle, you start to build the tension, and then you have the payoff, the gunshot. So it's kind of a narrative, it's a story arc in itself, even though it's, you know, it's not maybe a story as you would think of it normally. So this one here, this is kind of another shot one. I'm showing you a lot of shot promos. Most of the stuff is edited that I do, like Man on Fire, but this is another one. Maybe it's because I think they're more fun. Limo Fever, just gonna play this for you.
Class, high camp, kitsch, black, white, trash, nightclub, cheap tack, hen stag, binge, drink, bridegroom, stretch, leather, back seat, air con, TV, neon light, sham, pain, bar, rock, star, hire, car, travel, sick, pleasure, money. Life behind the tinted glass. Limo Fever starts next Thursday at 9 on Sky One.
Yeah, okay, so Limo Fever there. That's a very simple promo in some ways. It was good fun to shoot. But in terms of kind of telling a story, what I did there was, I don't know if the beat of the music is very sort of regular. And at the start, so maybe for the first 10 seconds, there's a word kind of on four beats of the bar of music, if anyone's musical. I'm not that musical, but the rhythm is, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, kitsch, black, white, trash, cheap, tech. And, you know, it's just like, wow, you know, like throwing these ideas out that are related to limousines. And then kind of round about the halfway point, I changed the pace of the delivery of the script. So instead of it being like 1, 2, 3, 4, it goes down to 1, 3. So sham, pain, bar, rock, star. So just the change of pace gives, like, you know, a change in mood. And then at the very end, I go from the sort of two words per bar to the finale is something like pleasure, sick. I think I can't remember now, but it finishes on money, and money is one word for the whole bar. And it gives it that sort of emphasis that, oh, this is all about money, whether it's about pretending you've got money because you've just hired the limousine, you can't really own it, or maybe you've got a limousine and you are rich, or maybe you own the company that rents the limousines out and you make money that way. But, you know, we associate limousines with people and money. And that was the finale. I'm just checking a couple of questions here. Yeah, I work a pretty standard week, maybe 40 hours a week, 5 8-hour days. I did a shoot on Tuesday, which is slightly different. So on a shoot, I got to the studio for 7:30, and I left the studio around about 7 o'clock. So that was more like a 12-hour day, but that's kind of unusual. And if I'm working on something that's got a tight deadline, then I'll do longer days. So, my hours might go up to 50 hours a week or, something like that. But I've been doing this for quite a long time, so I try and avoid crazy hours because there's always something else to do. There's always another project, and you've got to keep some energy for your next project. Let's see. And Da Vinci Resolve is, yeah, that seems to be coming on strong. I was talking to Matthijs just earlier before we started. The stuff we shot was in 4K, and Resolve seem, Da Vinci Resolve seems to handle 4K really well. And it's free to use, so it's going to be very popular. And I believe I haven't really used Resolve myself at all. I've opened it up once or twice just for fun. But I believe in recent versions, they've really, it used to be a color grading tool. And I think in recent versions, they've really added the editing capability to it. So it's no longer just a color grading tool. It's kind of like becoming a fully fledged editor that is also an amazing color grading tool. So that is one to watch. For me, Premiere is very much my editing tool, and I'm finding Lumetri for quick grades for me works really well within Premiere. How did you get into bigger companies like Sky? So that's a good question. There's nothing special about it, and the people who work for big companies are not necessarily any better. And sometimes it's not as good as you think you might be. It can sometimes be a bit of a golden cage. You think that you're working for some great company, but maybe there's rules, or office politics or brand limitations that you find frustrating. So it can be really good, or maybe not as quite as amazing as you hoped it would be. I do a lot of work for Disney at the moment, and I really like them, but I know that they're a big brand, and they're obviously kid friendly, and so they're very careful about their brand and don't want to take any risks with anyone. So say if you have a kind of wacky idea, they might not really want to run with it if it's a bit too edgy, and you might have to accept that they don't want to take a risk. Whereas if you were working for maybe a smaller channel, they would let you take the risk. And sometimes smaller companies with smaller budgets will take bigger risks, and they will let you have more creative freedom. So it's a balancing act between working on the big movies like Avengers Affinity or whatever, or Star Wars. So if I was working for Sky, I'd get to work in those, but I probably wouldn't be able to do something crazy with them. And let's see what else we got. My first job, let me see, my first job was as it was called a production assistant. It's a long time ago, so I had to think about that. I mean, I did small jobs, I'm talking like a week at a time, where you just go into a company and you make everyone the tea, and you do the photocopying, and clean the boss's car or whatever it is. So I guess that's called a runner or a gopher. I did that for a while. It can be quite hard to break in. And then I was lucky. I moved to Hong Kong, and without a job, because I had a friend who said I could sleep on his floor. And it was in Hong Kong that I got my first sort of proper TV job. And that was working for a company it was working for a movie channel, but I was a production assistant. I was an associate producer, which is one up from a production assistant. And I was making sort of half an hour shows about related to the movies, that maybe based on interviews with composers or interviews with directors, or maybe it was just a top 10 box office rundown. And I did that for a few years before I moved into promos. The inspiration question. You get inspiration. I get my inspiration anywhere. It's a very kind of vague answer, because it'd be nice if I could say there's a really good book that you should buy and it'll give you inspiration, but that's not the case. You just get it from your life and who you are and your friends and your family and your hobbies or your interests. If you're mad about playing, say, like my son is mad about playing Fortnite at the moment. I don't know if you guys are playing Fortnite. But it's full of creativity, you know, you see that on YouTube, you start watching YouTube and you see people doing the dances for the Fortnite dance competition or whatever, the memes that come out of that, whatever. There's loads of inspiration there. The internet's full of inspiration. Vimeo and YouTube are full of amazing stuff. But just walking down the street, reading magazines, stories, and you know, just the newspaper. There's currently a story in the UK. There's just so many amazing stories that you know you could make a drama about or a story. So inspiration is literally everywhere, and it will strike you at the strangest time. And unfortunately, sometimes when you need inspiration, it can be hard. And maybe that's when, you know, like you can get yourself a small book from, you know, the library or Amazon that, you know, tips to get ideas. And those things are quite good, because sometimes if you've literally got a blank, it can help you. But I think it will just come. Just before the deadline. Yeah, Matthijs, nothing. A bit of pressure is quite often good to get your creative juices flowing. I'll just move on. Let's see what else I've got next. I'm trying to... Yeah, so just carrying on with this kind of storytelling theme. Something that I've noticed is a simple structure, even if your story is complex, a simple structure can be really useful and, you know, start, middle, and an end. So, you know, set the scene, introduce your characters, so kind of the audience knows what we're dealing with, create the drama, but then, you know, what's the finale or the payoff? If you think of something like a joke, I know with another group that Matthijs is working with, they've done some jokes as, you know, film jokes, and it was really successful. But I also know, like the folktale thing, you know, a simple story like Cinderella or Goldilocks or whatever it is, you know, Jack and the Beanstalk. They're really simple stories. And I think sometimes maybe people in the media, myself included, we can get a little bit self-indulgent and, you know, oh, I want to make it this weird story and blah, this and that. And, you know, I've done that myself. But you do that kind of thing and you think you're doing good work, but maybe the audience are a bit like, meh, you know, I didn't get it. I didn't understand it. And I know I've got a friend that I've known for many years. So I used to know him when he was making short films. And now he's directed a few feature films successfully. And, you know, he directs television, etc., television dramas. And I remember on some of his early short films that, you know, he wrote and directed himself, he would give me the script to read, you know, for my opinion. And I'd be kind of like, I don't understand it. I don't, you know, what's going on? And maybe after a few of those, he made a short film that was based on a folk tale. And because the folk tale story was so simple and clear, it was by far my favorite of his short films. So I think there was a bit of a lesson there that, you know, you can have your own stories, but you have to keep the narrative clear at some point so people can follow it and enjoy it. So I think I've got, I'll play one more. I'll make this my last one. Ultimate Sci-Fi Top 10 Robots.
So who's your fave sci-fi robot then?
I'm a big fan of the Daleks and their work.
Bit retro. I'm a RoboCop fan myself.
Get your beers in. You have 10 seconds to comply.
Ultimate Sci-Fi Top 10 Robots, Monday at 8 on Sky One.
So yeah, so that one, Ultimate Sci-Fi Top 10 Robots, was a bit of a weird show. But I think my inspiration for that was just the title of the show. It was a show, you know, like Top 10, what's the best robot? You know, is it R2-D2 from Star Wars? Or is it RoboCop? Or is it, I'm trying to think of other famous robots. I've run dry. But it just seemed like a weird notion. And I had this idea of like a couple of people in the pub, because, you know, people in the, you know, go down the pub and say, oh, you know, that's my favorite Blair. That's my favorite footballer. That's my favorite movie. You know, the Porsche is my favorite car. So yeah, you know, it seemed like they're the right setting. And I really like this spot. I did it quite a long time ago. It's kind of a personal favorite. I don't know why. It's my sense of humor. But I know, I think my boss at the time didn't like it. he thought it looked cheap or something like that. And it was cheap. It was done for a small budget. But, you know, I'm not bothered. I think it's good and I still like it. I don't know what's happened with this screen, but I'm going to skip it. I'm going to skip this as well because I was just being silly. Well, so talking about short form, I'll play this anyway. You know, how quickly can you tell a story? And I just saw this on the internet and I thought it was quite funny. So I'm going to play this.
But this chef can't sing.
Yeah, so that's how fast you can tell a story. They say in 5 seconds, but it lasted longer. And that's about, yeah, that's my, I think that's my presentation. So thanks for listening to me. How many promos have I made? Yeah, I've made a lot, I guess. Typically, I would make one. It depends which company you work for. Some companies you might make one every 2 weeks. Other companies you might make one a week because there'll be faster turnaround. So, you know, maybe we say like on average one every 2 weeks. So you're doing about 20 a year. And I've been doing it for about, it feels like 20 years. So that would be about 400 promos. So yeah, a lot of promos. Any other questions? On a side note, I'm working for Disney at the moment and we do a lot of languaging because, you know, it's a global business these days. And so recent projects that I've been working with, I've been doing in 13 languages. One of which is Netherlands, which is confusing because sometimes it's Flemish or Dutch. I get very confused. But yeah, every now and then I have to work with somebody. So somebody comes in, a Dutch speaker, to check if I'm getting things right. So yeah, you never know. You might listen to some of my work in Dutch. Have I worked on feature films? No. Have I? I don't think I have. No. It's a thing, you maybe find this when your career starts, that you go down a branch of a career or a branch of an industry. So if you think, like, if Matthijs and I were talking about lens-based media, so, you know, some of you will end up working for corporate video, some of you will end up working for online video, some of you will end up working in the video games industry, some will work for TV, some will work in advertising, some will work in features, and they're quite separate. You know, once you go down one route, very quickly, that's you. You know, you it becomes what you know, and your network, and you get offered jobs because people will say, "Oh, we saw that you did one, you know, whatever it is you do. So can you do that for us?" So if I was, you know, an editor in feature films, I would get invited to cut more feature films. But the flip side of that is, if you're like a colorist in advertising, you'll do a lot of colorizing for adverts, and maybe not so much for feature films. Uh-huh. So yeah, I don't do feature films. What gets you inspired? Sort of covered this a little bit earlier, but random things. Sometimes work by my peers, sometimes I'll see a promo and I'll think, wow, I wish I made that. That's my highest praise. You know, when you see something and you think, ah, I wish that was mine. So occasionally I see things like that. It could be an advert on TV. So sometimes, you know, movies, I'm just trying to think. The internet is a huge resource. It's fantastic. It's hard to, you know, it's hard to imagine life without the internet now in terms of creative inspiration. Your colleagues, you know, people around you at school, there's just always people doing stuff, cool stuff. Sometimes, you know, like, another freelance guy that I know, he's been out to Afghanistan and he showed me some really cool stuff that he did, where he had one of those, you know, those cheap 360 cameras. I think it's a Pentax one for about, I don't know, like 300 euros. But he, you know, he drove through some town in Afghanistan on the back of a tank, filming in 360 degrees. And that's available to watch on some news channel from Brazil. But, you know, people show you things and you're just like, wow, you know, like, that's amazing. So, yeah, could come from anywhere. An internship. Tips for an internship. That's a really tricky question. If you do get an internship, try and really get involved in as much as you can, because it can be hard, I think, for young people. And you go into a company or someplace and it's hard to be productive because everyone else has got a role that they do and you're almost like a visitor or a tourist. But the more you offer to help, the more you'll get involved. And be confident about yourself, you know, be, you know, Don't offer to do something that you can, there's no way that you can do it. But, you know, be confident to sort of say, yeah, like, please, can I help? Please, can I get involved? So that you do get a chance to do really good things, or at least to watch the exciting stuff that's going on. Aha, gear. Getting started. You guys are starting at a great time because if you've got a mobile phone, the chances are it's got a video camera. DaVinci Resolve, as we talked about earlier, is a free editing software. So, you know, you've got access to really good kit or good, you know, software anyway. So, like, don't worry. And this is related to the gear. Gear is very unimportant compared to your talent and your ideas and your enthusiasm. Gear is, don't worry about gear. You'll get to a point professionally where gear becomes important in that your client will say you must deliver this at HD resolution, and therefore that means that your camera has to shoot HD resolution and your edit software has to handle HD resolution or whatever it is, 4K or Ultra HD or whatever it is. But until you get to the level of having a client that demands a specific technical level, it's really about just you and having fun and experimenting and, spending as much time as you can and you enjoy doing, taking photos, filming your friends, filming whatever it is, cutting, and if you find just as much as possible, that's where you'll get your skills. And it's an interesting time because you guys, if you're interested in this kind of stuff, media, you will have to really push yourselves because there will be other people who are maybe not doing a course in media, but they will have, a laptop at home and they will have DaVinci Resolve and they'll be filming. So in a way that maybe the competition for you guys will be harder than it was for me because less people were doing film and video when I did it and it's more accessible to more people. So therefore, just the more that you can do to build your skills, the better. London, yeah, London's a great place. London's a very big media hub, and I think particularly now, maybe more than ever, going back to a point I made that hello, I've got bigger. A point that I made about me working with multi-language projects. So my last project, I think I was working in 14 languages, and English was just one of those languages. And so we have to work with people from different countries. And there are I think production companies and agencies that are specializing. So say I might make, if I did advertising, I might make an advert for the UK market, but then some other team might then reversion that for the French, German, Netherlands, wherever, whatever market it may be. And if you guys, I believe you guys speak pretty good English, so that puts you could work in London just with as an English speaker. But if you've got a second language, that's a great thing to have. So yeah, London's a good place. I recommend, see if you can ask around, see if there's any opportunities. Big companies like Disney, they have a very official internship program. So, you would apply for that, I think, through the kind of proper channels at Disney. I think a lot of the big companies do that. So, it's a very much an official process. But I work with quite a lot of interns, and I think they do great work and they get great experience. So yeah, try and find an internship with a good company like Disney would be a great thing. Any more questions?
I'm back as
Another.
Hi, thank you so much, David. It's kind of quiet now in the chat room, so I think they don't have any questions left. Very great, great story, and luckily you had more time to tell your story this week than over at the Education Exchange session last week. And I'm happy that I've heard more about your workflow, your creative workflow, and nice to see all those projects next to each other and see what the differences are. So let's give David a virtual grand applause for his session. And I think this was a very inspiring and evening where we've learned a lot. So thank you so much, David.
Yeah. It's great fun. You're very welcome. It's actually quite fun for me to kind of almost like a retrospective, you know, we in life, which is a thing, maybe like it's a shame we quite often don't stop and think who we are, what we're doing, how did we get here? Yeah. Should I have gone here, or should I try and go a different direction? Or should I change, you know? So yeah, really interesting. It's a great experience for me, and thanks for giving.
You're very welcome. So yeah, I think we are going to wrap up this session. I'm going to stop the recording right now.